This episode is sponsored by Squarespace. Go to squarespace.com/microcosmos to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Look, we try to think about our vocabulary here on Journey to the Microcosmos, and we know that it's bad form to return to the same word over and over again, but whenever we write about amoeba, we will probably say the word blob a lot. You can't really help that. There's just no better pairing of the English language with the microcosmos. And today, well, today will be twice the blob, because the amoeba we're looking at is the usual blob, encased in a somewhat unfamiliar blob. We've actually seen these amoeba before on our journey through the microcosmos, but they looked really different then. They were striking, but the colors and shape were a little more muddied compared to the sharp detail we saw in the beginning of this episode. Looking at this, you might feel like this footage looks like the work of a microscopist early in his learning, and you would be correct. These were one of the first organisms that James found when he started his own journey. At the time, he didn't even know what he was looking at, just that it was incredible. It's been years since this sighting, but James hadn't been able to find these purple amoeba again. And that was disappointing, because not only had his skills as a microscopist improved, but his tools had as well. When he got the microscope he uses regularly now, he just really wanted to find the purple amoeba again to see what he would be able to observe this time around. We're watching the purple amoeba through that microscope now, so obviously James has found it again, but it took years. He looked everywhere, even taking in moss samples from all over Europe, but again and again they failed to turn up the purple amoeba. So where did James finally find them? Outside of his own home, of course. They were living in a patch of moss that was watered by the runoff from his building's gutter. We don't know if there's a name for those times when you've spent years hunting a microbe only to find it right outside your door, but maybe we should call it James's Law. The name of this microbe is Amphizanella violacea, and it was first described in 1866 by a scientist named Greif. But while it's been observed since then, it doesn't seem to have sparked much science, aside from a 2006 paper that discusses the organism with enough details to help us better understand its life, but otherwise, it's kind of a mystery. For example, the color. We can see the purple pigments streaming around the cytoplasm of the amoeba, but we don't know what those pigments actually are. One theory is that they are a pigment called gliocapsin, and that they're actually the product of cyanobacteria that the amoeba likes to eat, but we don't know if that's actually the story behind how the amoeba turned purple. Interestingly, scientists have also found this amoeba without the purple pigments, and in those cases, the amoeba has been more of a yellowish color, which might explain some of the yellow spots we see here. If we look more closely at the surface, we can see the oval-shaped nucleus toward the center of the screen, along with vacuoles that make the amoeba's surface look kind of like a purple moon. But the thing we're most intrigued by is that weird mucousy jelly-like layer around the amoeba that you can see here. It's like if a microbe could have an aura, that's what it would look like, maybe. And in that layer, you can sometimes find plenty of rod-like bacteria. With the amoeba out of focus, you can really see those bacteria here, decorating the mucus structure like sprinkles on a very weird and, yes, blobby cupcake. Given all that we have said about that gelatin layer, your eyes might be trying to find it here, on this smaller, younger Amphizanella. Don't worry though, your vision hasn't suddenly failed you. These younger Amphizanellas just don't have that mucus layer. There are times where the Amphizanella loses both its color and its outer mucus layer, though it's for a good reason. When conditions around it aren't good, Amphizanellas turn to a beloved strategy in the microcosmos: they form cysts. Fortunately, but also a little unfortunately, our amoebas seem to be quite content, so we can't see those cysts right now. But in the process of preserving itself, the color shifts from purple to brown, and the mucus layer ends up spreading out over the surface. When the amoeba decides to leave its cyst, it will have to create that layer again from scratch. But the exact process of making that structure and the role it serves for the amoeba are still poorly understood. This information is all coming from that one 2006 paper whose samples came from mosses that had been collected from roofs and walls around Germany. It's an origin that shares a kinship with our own amoeba, which likely descended through the gutter from James's rooftop and into a patch of moss for him to collect from. That parallel is kind of endearing. After all, this is an organism that doesn't have the same wealth of literature about it that some other microbes we discuss have. We were able to learn enough to describe what we're seeing, but not enough to sketch out more of the contours of its life. Yet, we can see the story of our amoeba through someone else's eyes and experience the same details through observations they made almost 20 years ago. And we hope that now that we've found James's purple amoeba again, perhaps someone else will see a parallel to what they find under their own microscope, illuminating not just the organism, but also the mysteries of its life. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. And thank you to Squarespace for sponsoring this episode. Squarespace offers an incredible online platform from which to create your website. Whether you're a budding entrepreneur looking to expand your current venture, Squarespace provides all the necessary tools to help you thrive. Maybe you have a passion for gourmet baking and want to establish an impressive online presence for your bakery. Squarespace enables you to craft a visually stunning and professional website that showcases your delectable creations and embodies your unique brand. With their comprehensive suite of features, including third-party extensions, you can effortlessly manage your inventory, simplify bookkeeping, and ship your baked goods worldwide. And if you want to share your baking journey and engage with fellow baking enthusiasts, Squarespace makes it a breeze to create a seamlessly integrated blog alongside your bakery's online store. You can captivate your readers by sharing your latest recipes, baking tips, and behind-the-scenes insights into your creative process, and you can engage in meaningful conversations with your clientele through threaded comments and replies, cultivating a passionate community of baking enthusiasts. Start building your online bakery today by signing up for a free trial at squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, don't forget to visit squarespace.com/microcosmos to enjoy a 10% discount on your first purchase of a website or domain. Experience the power of Squarespace and watch your bakery business rise to new heights. The people on the screen right now are our Patreon patrons, who allow us to continue to bring you weird organisms that are very rarely seen by human eyes and have been described not very often and are not easy to find, but sometimes suddenly become extremely easy to find because they were on the roof the whole time. Thank you so much. If you want to join them, you can go to patreon.com/journeytomicro. If you want to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you want to see more from us, there's probably a subscribe button somewhere nearby.